Let's all clap unto Jesus again tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Hallelujah. Enjoy the good Holy Ghost worship and singing and playing. Amen. And isn't it wonderful just getting together and worship and praising God? Hallelujah. And seeing people just praise Him in the freedom and liberty of the Holy Ghost. And thank you so much for inviting us up. Brother Jonathan had talked with me and asked me if we could come, and this is just a wonderful blessing. How many know we couldn't do anything without Jesus? Without Him, we could do nothing. Praise God. And sister, we appreciate you holding these meetings like this, and good to meet everybody. And man, a brother from Alabama's here, and all the way around, all over the country. Praise God. And so we're just really appreciated and humbled that we're invited to come like this. And it's nothing better than getting together and just worshiping the Lord like this. Hallelujah. And keep us in prayer this weekend, because they mentioned Brother Gilbert North. I'm going to be marrying his daughter and her fiance tomorrow. And so we're going to be with the Norths tomorrow. And then I got to preach 3 times Sunday. So I'm preaching tonight, doing a wedding tomorrow, I'm preaching 3 times Sunday. It's supposed to be my vacation starting tomorrow. So I'm going to get a good work before I go on vacation. I'm going to need a vacation now. But God's so good. And I don't think I've been up here before. I might have driven by on the highway somewhere. But somebody said, is it Oak Point? And I said, yes, they mentioned it's Oak Point. And praise God. So it's just good to be here. Really appreciate this. And we're going to have a good time in the Holy Ghost. How many know we're having a good time in the Holy Ghost tonight? Praise God. So if you like shouting amen when the preaching goes, shout amen as much as you want. Wave your hands, run the aisles. I don't care what you do. Just give God the glory. Amen. Because He deserves it. Let's clap again unto Him. Hallelujah, God. Thank you, Jesus. And I love the word of the Lord. How many love the word of the Lord? Brother Jonathan mentioned about our sword, and I wanted to bring the sword. God gave me so many sermons about the book of Genesis and the Garden of Eden and the flaming sword that was in the garden. I just love preaching from Genesis. And so how many know the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword? Praise God. I walked in and the brother on the guitar, I said, I got a sword with me. And he said, want to know what the real sword is? And I pointed at my Bible. That's the real sword, isn't it? How many know the real sword is the Word of God? Right. Amen. And it's sharper. Any sword like this, the Word of God is far more sharper than any two-edged sword. And that's because it's the Word of God. And so I'm going to read from Genesis chapter 3. And again, like I said, God gave me so many messages from the book of Genesis. And I felt to preach this here tonight. And I'm glad to have my son with me. And isn't it good, Brother Jonathan? You got boys to lead in the way of the Lord. And my son actually plays guitar with Fresh IE. And so he's been traveling around with him too. And it's good to have him with me here tonight. But I want to read from Genesis 3. And I want to take you through the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. And we're going to be here about 14 hours. No, I'm just kidding. We're not going to do 14 hours. But I'm going to take you from Genesis to Revelation, though, and show you a beautiful message, a thread of thought from the beginning to the end that shows us what Jesus Christ really did for us. Aren't you glad He's King of Kings and Lord of Lords? He conquered the devil. Hallelujah. He got the keys of death and hell. He took the devil's keys from his own house. And Jesus has them now. The devil used to have the power of death, but Jesus has the keys of death and hell tonight. Amen. Aren't you glad? You don't have to be afraid of the devil. If you know Jesus, the devil's more afraid of you than you could ever be afraid of him. Hallelujah. He's just afraid we'll realize that. Amen. We need to realize that. And so the word of the Lord, I believe God wants to help us get victory over some things. I believe we can have victory over anything. Everything. Jesus gave us power over all the works of the devil, not just part of it, all of it. And He overcame the devil completely. Praise God. And how many know he's King of Kings right now? Jesus is King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Yes. Praise God. And so let's go back to Genesis chapter 3. And I'm reading in verse 14 and 15. This is after Adam and Eve had disobeyed the Lord and sinned. And the Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. Somebody say, eat dirt.
Eat dirt.
Say, Satan, eat dirt. That's what God told him. He's going to eat the dust of the ground, the dirt. And then he said, and the devil was really listening to what God was saying here. Because he said, I'm going to put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. Amen. And all of a sudden the devil realized somebody was coming. There was going to be a seed of the woman that was going to come. And the Bible said, it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. And the devil listened to that closely, and I guarantee you the devil never forgot those words. Somebody was going to come, and we know it was going to be a man, because it said, it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel.
His heel.
His heel. Amen. And you know, the devil's not stupid. You put two verses together that talk about bruising, he's going to bruise your head, and you're going to bruise his heel. Well, that means the heel's going to go down on top of the head. Right. Praise God. You know, I wouldn't mind getting my heel bruised if it's going to crush the head of the devil. Hallelujah. And then down in verse 22, God had to cast them out of the garden, Adam and Eve. And it says, and the Lord God said, behold, the man is become as one of us to know good and evil. And now, lest he put forth his hand also and take of the tree of life and eat and live forever. Therefore, the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. Mm-hmm. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword, which turned every way. Picture this sword on fire tonight. Woo. And it turned every way. In the entrance of that garden, like a ball of fire. It just wasn't a sword standing still. It turned every way. In fact, if you would have saw that, you would have seen like it looked like a ball of fire in the middle of that entrance to that garden. And then it said there was cherubims alongside with this flaming sword, and it would keep the way of the tree of life. In other words, it would protect it. Now I can see the flaming sword doing a good job of protection. But I want to really talk about these cherubims too as I preach tonight. And in fact, I'm going to use the cherubims through my whole message. And as if, how many know the Bible says angels desired to look into the things that we see?
That's right.
In fact, many holy men and wise men, Jesus said, desire to know the things that you know and have not known them. But you know them. And it said angels have desired to look into these things. So I'm going to use that scripture and talk about these cherubims from their perspective as if they were trying to watch and figure out what was going on. And I'll tell you why I'm going to use them in a moment, because there's a very important point. But I want to preach tonight on swords, cherubim, and dirt. Praise God. How many want to hear a good message about getting victory over Satan tonight? How many like to see the devil eat some dirt tonight? Amen. Hallelujah. Let's all praise God. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the truth, the sword of the Spirit. We thank you, God, for the Bible, these services. Lord, let the Holy Ghost move through this whole weekend. Let people be set free. Let every spirit of the devil be defeated and crushed beneath feet here. And I pray, God, let this word go and touch everyone in this house here tonight. Lord, under this wonderful tent out in the open air, let the Spirit of God bless and move. And Lord, you came to set the captive free. We're continuing your work. So Lord, let's see captives set free tonight by the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Lord, let your Spirit, let the Word of God release every prisoner tonight in Jesus Christ's name. And whatever bondage there is whatsoever, let it be broken in the service, and we give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Let's clap unto him again tonight. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Now, the Bible says the serpent was a beast of the field. It was more subtle than any beast of the field. Now, the serpent was something that the devil entered into. It was an animal that the devil possessed. He needs a body if he's going to do anything in this world, because he's a spirit. And he found a physical creature that he could use that creature's abilities. And does anybody remember what kind of ability that creature had? It said it was the most subtle beast of the earth. More subtle than any of the beasts of the earth. And subtle means it's sly and it's cunning and it's crafty. And the devil can't create anything. All he can do is take something God made and twist it. Yeah. How many know Jesus got angry at different times? Yeah. Do you remember when he walked inside of the temple and he saw them changing money? And he got angry and he flipped the tables, the money changers. Thanks, brother. And that was anger. But there's also an evil anger. And that's because the devil takes something God has and he twists it. How many know there's obviously good love, but the devil can even twist love. And the Bible talks about vile affection. How could affection be vile? But the Bible talks about, so the devil took this creature that God made and he took its cunningness and its craftiness and its subtlety and he twisted it to his purposes. And now evil was outside the garden. That's why God said, Adam, dress and keep the garden. Everybody say, keep it.
Keep it.
That means protect it. A keeper is a protector or a guardian. But did you just notice at the end of Genesis 3 that cherubim and a flaming sword was going to keep the way of the tree of life now? Adam and Eve were supposed to be keeping the garden, but now they had to be thrown out, and cherubim and a sword was going to keep that garden, protect it. The problem is that Adam got the very thing he was supposed to keep out of the garden in himself. Everybody say sin. He had sin in his life when he disobeyed God. And so God didn't want that in there. That was what Adam was supposed to keep outside the garden. Because outside of the garden, God had cast Satan down into the earth. Jesus said, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. And that devil was out in that earth. And Adam was going to have, he had dominion over the earth. He was like a king. Just how many know Adam was the image of God? And just like God is king and rules the heavens, his image was going to rule the earth because he was God's image. And the devil was just kicked out of heaven, and he did not want to be kicked out of the earth. And that's why he went after that man and he went after that woman. And he said, I've got to stop them because I'm going to be thrown out of this world. Do you know the devil's going to be thrown into the lake of fire one day? Praise God, that's coming. But way back then, it should have happened. But Adam let the enemy have his way. And that's where the problem all came from. And so Adam now had sin in him, and God had to take him out of the garden, out where the rest of evil was. And then Satan, that old serpent, must have said, yes. Me eat dirt? Never. And the devil remembered what God had said to him about a seed going to come, and he knew it was going to be a man, and he watched and he looked for any candidate that might be that seed of the woman. And he said, not on my life am I going to eat dirt. I am going to make man eat dirt. I'm going to stuff his face into filth, into mud, into dirt. I'm going to make him suffer. I won't eat dirt. Man is going to eat dirt. And Satan went to work. Now, amidst all of those curses, that seed of the woman that God spoke about that was going to bruise the devil's head while his heel would be bruised. Praise God, Adam even remembered it. Do you notice, here God is, cursing the serpent, and he cursed the woman so that she'd suffer when she'd give birth to children. And he didn't curse Adam, but he cursed the ground for Adam's sake. But after all those curses, isn't it wonderful that when Adam names his wife, he calls her Eve, the mother of all living? Because he heard God say, a seed is going to come. He's going to bruise that devil's head. And Adam and Eve might have been having to get out of that garden, but praise God, God said there's an answer coming. There's a child going to be born one day. And he's going to take that very devil that tempted you and caused you to leave the garden and crush his head. Hallelujah. And so he remembered that and called her mother of all living, because the child was going to come one day. And he held on to that. Aren't you glad he came one day? Hallelujah. Jesus Christ was born of a woman. Amen. In fact, the devil, he went after the woman to tempt the woman first before he went after Adam. And the Lord said, you shouldn't have done that, because now through the woman, I'm going to bring a child one day. Born of a woman. Everybody say, born of a woman. Hallelujah. And Jesus Christ came one day. But don't let me get ahead of myself here. You see, the Bible talks about these cherubims later on. It only tells you that they were there in Genesis 3. But if you go to Ezekiel chapter 10, it mentions the cherubims again. And I want you to see what the rest of the Bible says about these cherubims. In fact, chapter 10 verse 12 says, their whole body and their backs and their hands and their wings and the wheels were full of eyes. Can you imagine a creature that all over its body, its back, and it had wings? Does anybody know how many wings these cherubims had? Six. Six wings. How many ever saw these pictures of angels? They always seem to look like pretty women, and they got two big wings. Well, I never even saw a female angel in the Bible anywhere. And not only that, when I read about the cherubims and they've got wings, they got six of them, not two, and there's eyeballs all over them. There's eyes on their backs, there's eyes on their wings, there's eyes all over them. Now, can you imagine? We'd think it'd be so beautiful to see an angel. I think I'd scream if I saw one of these things. There's eyes on their arms, their backs, their wings. And now in Ephesians, do you remember what Paul said? The eyes of our, something being opened. The eyes of our understanding. Yes. Everybody say eyes. Represent understanding. And when there's eyes all over these creatures, this is biblical imagery for intense watchfulness or intense seeking for understanding. And that's why I'm going to use these cherubims, because with eyes all over them, just as if God is trying to show us, understand, understand. These creatures represent understand. There's something happening here. Angels wanted to, they were watching all of this happen. They were watching Adam and Eve taken out of the garden. They were watching how God didn't just destroy that garden, and he didn't put a brick wall up there that would permanently keep man out. He only put a sword there beside these cherubims. And so man was now outside, and these cherubims were watching all of this. Intense watchfulness. Why keep the garden there? Why protect it? Why not just take it out of the whole world, because man sinned and he lost his opportunity? But no, God says, I'm going to protect this way of life, because man's going to come back again one day. Aren't you glad God protected the way of life? He didn't remove it, he protected it. Hallelujah. And Satan can try all he wants to, but there's still a way of life. Praise God. Why not remove the garden? Why is there such odd creatures there? And the sword would do the work all by itself. It would cut down anyone that would try to enter. But why are these cherubims there? And if you go to Ezekiel 1, chapter 1, verse 6, it said, not only did these things have eyes all over them, they each had four faces. It said everyone had four wings. There's four of them in this chapter. In Revelation, I'll show you, that's where they had six. But look at this in Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 10. As for the likeness of their faces, they four had the face of a man, the face of a lion on the right side. Therefore had the face of an ox on the left side. Therefore also had the face of an eagle. Everybody say a lion, ox, eagle, and man. You ever heard of two-faced people? These had four faces. Lion and ox. And this is what God put in the entrance of the garden. They got all these wings. They got all these faces. There's eyes all over them. And these are those creatures. And at the end of the Bible, in Revelation 4, verses 7 and 8, it mentions the lion, the ox, and the eagle, a man, all over again. But it doesn't call them cherubims. It calls them the four beasts. How many remember the four beasts of Revelation? It says in Revelation 4 and 7, the first beast was like a lion. The second beast like a calf. Everybody say ox. The third beast had a face as a man, and the fourth beast was like a flying eagle. The exact same creatures. And the four beasts had each of them six wings about him. And here it is again. They were full of eyes within. Full of eyes. Everybody say understanding. And they rest not day and night, saying, holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. And by the way, if you keep on reading Revelation, these beasts were around the throne. Just like these beasts were blocking the garden entrance. Did you know if God gave Adam dominion over the earth, and then Adam had to leave the garden where God gave him dominion, doesn't it sound like the garden was a throne room for Adam? And here in Revelation, the same creatures are around the throne. Somebody say the kingdom of heaven. And so, at the garden, cherubims have eyes. They're watching, they're watching, they're watching. Everything is going on. That's where God put man to rule over the world, to have dominion over everything. And it's like being with God in fellowship, if we could only get back inside that garden again. The Bible says Adam walked with God in the cool of the day. He fellowshiped God, but he lost that. And it was gone now. But there's a message, and those cherubim must have thought, we're protecting the way. Obviously, man's going to come back one day. He's going to come back. Somebody say, understand. And oh, how they wanted to understand this so much. You see, with God, we've got power. With God, we've got anointing. But without him, we can do nothing. Praise God. So meanwhile, the words the devil heard from God are eating away at him. And he's thinking, I will not eat dirt. No way will I eat dirt. And the first boy born must have reminded the devil of what God said about the seed of the woman. Does anybody remember the first name boy ever born? Cain. Because when you read Genesis 4, the Bible says Adam knew his wife, Eve, and she conceived and bare Cain and said, I've gotten a man from the Lord. Now, why would she cry that out? I got a man from the Lord. Adam, I've got a boy. It's a man. Because I believe they probably thought that was the seed of the woman. They weren't told it was going to be thousands of years before he'd come. For all they knew, the very first boy born was going to be that seed, and it was going to crush the devil's head. But I promise you, the devil thought the same thing. Because why was it that the Bible said Adam and his whole family outside the garden, Abel offers a sacrifice, Cain offers a sacrifice. And how many know the difference between Cain and Abel's sacrifices? Cain offered vegetables. Abel offered blood, and without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. And Cain did not offer a sacrifice by faith. By faith, Abel offered a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, Hebrews 11 tells us. And the Bible says Cain became jealous and angry. And God said, Cain, why are you angry? Sin is lying and crouching like a tiger at the door. Watch yourself. If you do right, I will accept your sacrifice like Abel's. But sin is lying at the door. The devil was after that one because he was afraid that was going to be the seed. Yeah. And sure enough, Satan got a hold of him. He killed his brother, and the first murder occurred. And Satan says, me eat dirt. Never will I eat dirt. And he was making man eat dirt if there's any way possibly he could do that. And the devil hissed, is this the seed? And the cherubim were watching. And Cain killed Abel. And then Noah comes along. And the devil's got mankind eating so much dirt, eating so much filth, sinning, in other words, so much that God said, I repent that I even made man. The imagination of man's thoughts was continually evil. And God says, I'm sorry I even made man. And the Bible says he put the cattle, the beasts, and the fowl in the ark. Now, go to Genesis 2 and 20 for a second. When Adam was still in the garden, Adam gave names to all. Everybody say cattle. He gave names to the fowl. Say fowl. And say to every beast. The cattle, the fowl, and the beast were named by Adam. And you know what I found out one day? I did a bit of research. What do they call the lion? The king of the beasts, right? Now, in Hebrew culture, the lion is the king of the beast also. But they also call a certain animal the king of the cattle. And then they call another animal the king of the fowl. The king of the cattle is the ox. The king of the fowl is the eagle. And isn't it interesting that the lion, the ox, the eagle, and the man were on the cherubims, and Adam named the cattle, the fowl, the beasts, and he even named his own wife. It's like these cherubims are looking and they're watching. In Noah's day, it's like I could imagine them saying to one another, look, Noah is putting cattle, beasts, and fowl into that ark. I'll show you where the Bible actually says that. Go to Genesis 9 and look at verse 10. It mentions these very creatures. Now, this is no coincidence. How many know the Bible is perfect and it fits together? Amen. Just like a hand in a glove. In Genesis 9 and 10, and with every creature that is with you, of the fowl, of the cattle, and of every beast of the earth with you, from all that go out of the ark to every beast of the earth. These creatures that the cherubim's faces represented were in the ark. They were the very ones Adam named. It's like Adam, when he was king, he had authority over every beast, over the fowl of the air. And he lost that authority when he left the garden. And these cherubims represent, this is what you used to have. If they were standing in the entrance of the garden and they were blocking Adam from getting into his throne room, it's like they were saying a message to him. Beyond this point, you had power over us. Beyond this point, you had power over the cattle, over the fowl, and over the beasts. But this is just a reminder, you're not in the throne room anymore. And the cherubim were watching this. What's God doing? The angels were looking. And first of all, God kept the way of the garden. Why did God keep it? What's he trying to do? And now that evil's so rampant in the world and God was sorry he even made man, he takes the very creatures that we represent and puts them in the ark and saves some of them. And he takes Noah with him and only 7 other people. 8 souls were saved by water. And what is God doing? Is this the time that he's going to bring man back again? Is the devil's head going to be crushed now? Is it Noah that's going to crush his head? And Satan caused the world to be so evil and thought to himself, I will never eat dirt. I've succeeded. I've got all the world full of sin. All they can think of is evil. But then he looks and says, what's God doing? He's calling a man, and he's getting that man's family, and they're escaping my clutches. I want God to destroy the earth. That's why I made man so wicked, because the devil thought, I'm not going down alone. If I'm going to go down to hell, I'm going to bring everybody with me I can go. Aren't you glad Jesus Christ can rescue us from a devil's hell? Woo! Hallelujah! Amen. And the devil couldn't stop it. He thought he was right on the verge. He was so close. He had the whole world. But 8 souls were rescued by God. You know, the Bible says Straight is the gate, narrow is the way, and few there be that find it? Well, there was only few back then. And how many know this world's getting quite a lot like it was in the days of Noah, where they're thinking evil continually? But how many want to be one of those few? Hallelujah. We're not going to bow. Hallelujah. He's going to take kids from drugs. He's going to take kids from the streets. He's going to get people off the roads, raise them up and make them people of God, make them warriors and crush the devil's head. Hallelujah. How many know he's still King of Kings and Lord of Lords? It might not look like it's very bright out there tonight. Spiritually speaking, it's getting darker and darker, but the darker the night, the brighter the light. Hallelujah. And Jesus is still King. Woo! Oh, let's praise him tonight. Hallelujah, God. And so he's wondering what's going on, and the cherubim are wondering, when is that sword going to be removed? When is man going to be able to go in there and eat of the fruit of life again and live forever? When are they going to get back? What's God doing? Something's happening. Noah is dealing with the very creatures that we represent. You see, it all connects us back to the garden somehow. Noah's ark connects us to the garden because it mentions the very creatures that Adam named in the garden. Oh, God had a plan and the devil didn't know what was going to hit him. Hallelujah. Woo, praise God. And so the devil kept working. And the devil worked in families where mums and dads can't say, I love you. And the kids never hear them say that to one another. And 10-year-olds get in gangs by shooting somebody. That's how they initiate themselves into a gang. And there's perversion in the world. And Satan's saying, me eat dirt, never, never, never. And then Moses comes along. And God says to Moses, build me a sanctuary, Moses, that I may dwell among my people Israel.
Yes.
And he builds the tabernacle, a holy building. And then inside of it, according to Exodus 26 and 31, he tells him to make a veil. And look what the veil looks like. Exodus 26 and 31, thou shalt make a veil of blue and purple and scarlet and fine twined linen of cunning work. With cherubim shall it be made. And the cherubims are watching all this. What's God doing? Look at what he's doing now. He's talking to Moses and he's telling them to build a holy place, and they're going to put a veil in there that's got pictures of us on there. Cherubims. Just like there was cherubims in the Garden of Eden keeping Adam out, now there's cherubims on this veil. So what's this veil all about? And then when you read verse 32, thou shalt hang it upon four pillars of shittim wood overlaid with gold. Their hooks shall be of gold upon the four sockets of silver, and hang the veil under the taches that thou mayest bring in thither within the veil the ark of the testimony. And guess what the ark of the testimony looked like? It was a gold chest with cherubims on top. There they are again. The same creatures that were blocking the garden. The same creatures that were pictured on the veil. Now there's an ark, and it's made out of gold, and it's got cherubims on it. And then it says, you're going to bring in thither within the veil the ark of the testimony, and the veil shall divide you. And the cherubims thought to one another, that's what we were doing in the garden. We were dividing man from the garden. We were keeping man out so he couldn't go to the tree of life. And now God tells Moses to make a veil with our pictures on it that's also dividing him from this holiest of holies. Is God going to finally bring man back? Why is he doing this? Is he showing us that's not a brick wall, that's a veil. You can move veils and you can go by them. And they thought, maybe it's now. Maybe Moses is that seed. Well, he wasn't that seed, but how many remember what Moses said? A prophet like unto me shall ye hearken to. The Lord thy God shall raise up a prophet like unto me. Unto him shall you hearken to. And you know what? Noah was a picture of Jesus. Moses was another picture of Jesus. And all of these pictures pointed to Jesus Christ. Aren't you glad Jesus is the way? Yes. Doesn't that tell you something? He's the way. The way was what was being blocked. The way of the tree of life was what was being protected. And Jesus comes and he says, I am the way. Oh, hallelujah. Isn't it beautiful? The Bible's building up. It's coming together. And so here they are. And then they watch this. They say, look at that ark. You see what they're doing with the Ark of the Covenant? That's got cherubim on it. And they're taking that ark and they're passing it by the veil, and it's going inside of a holiest of holies. Doesn't that kind of remind you of Noah's ark? It was an ark too. And Noah's ark, and I could see the cherubim thinking, Noah's ark took us, the cattle, the fowl, the beasts, and man, and transports them out of a wicked, filthy world and brings them into a brand new, perfectly clean world. Just like the ark takes these creatures and cherubim and brings them by the veil and puts them inside of this place. It's like God's trying to say, we're coming back, we're coming back. Man's coming. And then they really stop, because Leviticus chapter 9 says a man was called a high priest, and he all of a sudden walked by that veil, walked by those cherubims on the veil, and he has blood in his hand, and he sprinkles the blood on the Ark of the Covenant 7 times. Amen. And those cherubims are saying, is this coming back now? Can man get in? Look. It's just like they passed the entrance of the garden when they passed that veil. It's just like they're inside the garden when they're inside there. Has the way been finally made? Can man come back? And then the very next chapter, Leviticus 10, the high priest's two boys, Nadab and Abihu, offer strange fire before the Lord. And they pull the veil and step through, and something comes out of the skies and smites them dead. Does anybody remember what it says killed them? Fire from the Lord. Now you stop and think of this. The veil had cherubim on it, just like the garden entrance had cherubim blocking it. But what else was in the garden blocking man out? A fiery sword. A what sword?
Fiery sword.
What kind of sword? Fiery. And what is it that kills those two boys when they walk by the veil with the cherubims? Fire. In other words, the sword's still there. We thought for sure if that man could go in there with that blood, what's that mean anyway? He has to have blood. And they never had blood. They had strange fire. How many know it's nothing but the blood? Nothing but the blood? Nothing but the blood? God was telling them a message. They weren't getting it. But how many know we can see it now? It's by the blood of Jesus, hallelujah. But they didn't know that back then. They thought it was then, it was time. But they said there's something about blood that the guy had that the others didn't have. And he went on in, and they couldn't go. So the sword is still there. Its fire is still burning. It wouldn't let those boys in. And the devil's just probably puzzled what's going on, but he was glad of one thing. The way wasn't opened yet, and so far he hadn't seen that seed of the woman crush his head yet, and he hadn't been eating dirt, but he said, I'll guarantee you one thing, I'm going to keep man eating dirt. I'm going to keep man. And while Noah's day, only 8 people were saved out of that whole wicked world, Satan got all the nations of the earth, but he couldn't get Israel. And Israel was the nation that had that tabernacle that was kind of like a model of the Garden of Eden. Whew. And it's like the cherubim said to each other, hey, remember Noah's ark? God made a covenant with the fowl, the beasts, and cattle, and man. Our faces represent that. The lion, you're the king of the beasts. Eagle, you're the king of the fowl. Ox, you're the king of the cattle. And man, God gave him dominion. And if they carried creatures back in, and they're bringing another ark, the ark of Noah brought them into a new world, but the ark of the covenant brings them into a holiest of holies. Something is coming. God is showing that creation is getting back into the garden soon.
Amen.
How many know Romans 8 says, the whole creation groaneth, waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. It was brought into bondage, but not willingly. But praise God, the creation is going to be brought into the glorious liberty of the sons of God. How many know God's bringing this thing right back again? Woo! Aren't you glad to be part of it? Hallelujah! And so, people fell on their faces when those two boys died. And then God tells Moses, You shall not come at all times into the holiest of holies. Only the high priest can go in, and he can only go in once a year, but not without blood. But nobody else is going in. And the cherubim said, what's this about the blood? What, there's something about the blood here. And so, time went by. Satan continues to say, me eat dirt, not on my life. I don't know what God's doing, but I'm going to keep fighting as long as I can, because I will not eat dirt. Where is it, God? How about it, God? Where is this seed? I thought it was Cain, and I got rid of him. I thought it was Noah, and it wasn't him. I got him drunk and naked in his own tent. I thought it was Moses, and I made him so mad he hit the rock, and you wouldn't let him in the promised land. I'm nailing every one of these people that I think might be your seed. Where is he? And Satan kept looking. I've got no mud meatloaf yet. I've got no dirt dinner yet. Where is he? And there still wasn't a way past. But all of a sudden, the cherubim's eyes looked one day, and one was coming. And he was so clean, there wasn't a speck of dirt in him. He was pure, he was holy, and he made a statement that struck the cherubims with wonder that nobody ever said before. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me. And the cherubims look, is this too good to be true? The Father was in that garden, and now somebody says there's a way back, and it's a man. It's a man born of a woman. It's a seed of a woman. What is this? Is this the one? And Satan couldn't get enough away from this man, and Jesus Christ cast out his demons. He set people free from the dirt and the filth that the devil was trying to stuff their faces into. The devil didn't know what was hitting him. The more he tried to get at him, amen, the more power and victory Jesus Christ had. And Satan was going out of his mind. What am I going to do? This must be the one. This must be the seed of the woman. And the devil noticed his voice sounded an awful lot like the one that told me in the garden, a seed's going to crush my head. Woo, hallelujah. That sounds an awful lot like a voice I heard way back in the garden. And didn't they call him Son of God? You know, in Romans 5 and 14, it says in some ways Adam was like Christ, the one to come. But here's the real Adam, the last man Adam. Hallelujah, God. Amen. You might have knocked off the first Adam, but you're not going to get the last one, devil. And not only that, there's not going to have to be a third. There's not going to have to be a fourth. This is the last man Adam. He's going to win. He's going to crush your head, and he's going to bruise you, and you're going to eat dirt in the process, Satan. Ooh, somebody praise him tonight. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Everything is going back to the garden. And if we could see the unseen world, how many know we'd see sinners with slimy, slithery lizards crawling all over them? We'd see people wading in mud and dripping with dirt. We'd see such filth in the spirit realm crawling all over them. And Jesus was coming, and those rats, amen, devils like rats were running away from him. The light was shining wherever he went. He'd bust up a funeral and raise the dead. He'd unplug deaf ears and deaf ears open blind eyes. And then something so bizarre happened that just absolutely boggled the mind of the cherubims. One day, Jesus lets them take him to a cross. And the devil, just like he got inside of that serpent, he got inside of Judas. How many ever read in the Last Supper that when Judas left, Satan entered into him? It's the garden all over again. And he got inside of that disciple of Jesus. And the cherubim saw something in the spirit. How many remember when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane praying? Do you remember what he asked the Father to just put to the side and just avoid that for the time? Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. He wasn't holding a cup. He was praying so hard, the Bible says he was sweating drops of blood. And I can imagine the angels and the cherubim saying, what is going on? They're trying to understand. They're trying to understand. And they're watching him. And the Son of God, not only that, it wasn't just a park called Gethsemane. It wasn't just downtown Gethsemane. It was a garden of Gethsemane. Just like where Adam was and he messed up. Just like where Adam was and a serpent possessed of the devil came and destroyed him. And here comes that serpent Judas, possessed by the devil in another garden. And God said, the devil said, I did it once, I'm going to do it again. I'm going to bring him down. And the Bible says, Jesus Christ said, Father, it be possible, let this cup. What was that cup? Because in the spirit realm, you want to know what that cup was? It was full of all our filthy sin. It was the mud and the muck of every sin anyone had ever committed, every sin anyone ever would commit. And the cherubim are watching this, and they're just as stunned as Satan. Satan says, I can't believe this. For 3.5 years I tried to stop him, and now he's letting them take him, and he's drinking all of the muck and the filth that I pushed man's face in for centuries? This is crazy. He's eating. He's willingly taking it. I tried to stop him. I could not find it. Not even Pilate found any fault in him. And Jesus said, the devil hath nothing in me. Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. And Satan has nothing in me. But all of a sudden, Jesus is putting something in himself. The devil didn't even have to put it there. Jesus is putting it there himself. What is going on? He's taking that filth. He's taking that mud. And that was all of your sins, and it was all of my sins. And then as they led him to the cross, it was like he was walking up to the entrance of the Garden of Eden. And there it was, a sword standing at the entrance. Amen. And when Jesus went on that cross, he became sin for us. He who knew no sin became sin for us. Why? So that we might become the righteousness of God. Hallelujah. So he could clean us up. He's got to take it out of us. If we're full of filth, if we're going to be righteous, and he took your sin so you could be clean. Hallelujah, God. All the filth the devil puts into people, aren't you glad Jesus can take it out? Woo! Hallelujah. Amen. He could take out all that filth that made you eat dirt. Take out all of that sin. And Satan ran over to the fiery sword as Jesus approached it. Spiritually speaking, when Jesus was going to the cross, he was going to the sword of judgment. And the Lord was filthy from head to toe, and the devil couldn't believe it. What a fool! What a fool! Now he's putting it in himself, and he's walking right up to that sword. That sword's going to cut him down. It's going to destroy him, because nothing unclean can get in there. That's why I wanted man to be so filthy, full of dirt, that he'd never get back to God again. But Jesus marches and says not a word. He was led dumb like a lamb to the slaughter. Because he's the word, friend, and if he ever speaks that word, something's going to happen. The Bible says he could have spoken and 12 legions of angels would have thrown the world into hellfire. So he had to be quiet because he had to go to the cross. Hallelujah. And Jesus marches up and the devil says, this is too good to be true. This is just too good to be true. Son of God, remember he said, if you're the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. Well, Sonny, come on, what are you doing? Come on, you're falling into my hands. And the flaming sword started burning brighter. And it started whirling faster and faster and brighter and hotter. And the flames started licking as Jesus Christ walked closer and closer as they started nailing him onto that cross. And the sky blackened, demons filled the air. No man had ever had so much filth inside of him like Jesus Christ did. He had so much of our sin that Matthew 26 and 47 says, he cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? He was so full of sin. And Satan says, this is unbelievable. I didn't have to lift a finger. He did it all himself. But the cherubim said, there's got to be something happening here. There's got to be something building up. Satan's too stupid to see it, but we know this way of life was protected for a reason. And then he went crazy with delight. as the Lord screamed one last time, and the cherubims couldn't believe their eyes. It is finished! And he gave up the ghost and he died. But something happened the very moment he died. Ooh, hallelujah. In Matthew 27 and verse 51, just yonder over in the city of Jerusalem, the tabernacle was now a temple. In fact, that veil was still there, and there was still a holiest of holies. And on that veil, there were cherubim sewn in there. And the Bible says, behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, not from the bottom to the top, amen, because that would be man doing it. But from the top to the bottom, the veil was ripped by God himself. And the cherubim said, what's this mean? Is the way open now? Are we going to leave? Amen. Can we let man in now? What's going on? And the rocks quaked. They split. The Bible says an earthquake cracked everything around. And sword in the spirit. It's like the sword cut Jesus down. And Jesus died. But what is this about the veil ripping? And then Satan said, let's have a party in hell. We killed him. He's gone now. He's out of the way. I possessed one of his very 12 disciples. And we got him. And the demons started dancing and screaming in hell. The cherubim couldn't believe it because the sword was still there. The veil ripped, but what is it about that sword? And we were on that veil. That represented us. It's like we're not there. We're taken out of the way. What's that mean? And for 3 days, hell had a party. And Satan says, me eat dirt, never, never, never. I will never, Lord, you are dirt. You died. You took the filth right in your own life. Good move. You manifest as a man. You tried helping these pathetic people, and it worked for a little while, and I thought I was finished. But, and this was the smartest thing you did yet. Now, you're dead. You're out of my way. And now I'm going to mess them up and eat dirt more than ever. And the devil walked away proud and sat down on his throne in hell. But something dripped on his shoulder on the third day. Maybe it's just a maggot or something. What is that? And then he brushed it away and drip again, but this time it burned. And when he looked at it, it was red, and it was blood. And then the devil touched it, looked at the blood, and slowly looked over his shoulder. Where's a microphone stand? Somebody get me a microphone stand. Take the mic off it for me. Hallelujah, God. And maybe pull that down so it's straight. And the devil said, what is this behind me? Just make her straight. It's good right there. And Jesus is standing over the devil's shoulder. The Bible says he went into the nether parts of the earth and he took captivity captive. And he said, I'm here. Do you remember what I told you way back in the garden? You're going to eat dirt. The seed of the woman is going to crush your head and you're going to bruise his heel. Well, now payday has come, buddy. And he took the devil off his throne and the demons were frozen. Talk about hell freezing over. And Satan says, but he said, shut up. And he slapped the devil across the face and he hauled him over there. And then he took him and said, you made man eat dirt. Well, now it's your time to eat dirt. And he shoved the devil's face down. He put his foot on his head and crushed him and said, eat dirt, devil. You've been making people get stoned on drugs. Well, drugs, it's your time to eat dirt. You've been messing people up in adultery. Adultery, you're eating dirt now. And he shoved the devil's face in the earth and he said, eat it, eat it. I took it away from man and I'm making it go into your fat belly right now. You bald-headed, pointed-eared, pot-bellied, yellow-backed devil, you're eating dirt like you tried to eat man. You think I'm a fool? You think I don't live up to my word? I know the end from the beginning, Satan, and now you're eating dirt. Hallelujah. And he crushed his head, and he crushed his head, amen. And he said, come here, let me show you something else. And he walked over to that sword that was still in the entrance of the garden, and he walked up to it, and the sword of the spirit flashed out went against the sword of judgment, and it busted and shattered that thing to a million pieces. And the cherubim said, "This is it. There's the blood. Remember the blood? Jesus is the high priest. He opened the way. That's why the veil ripped. We're out of here. Man can come back in now. He's not only the high priest, he's the Ark of Noah." How many know we get inside of Jesus Christ and we are buried with him? We are resurrected with him. But the best part of it all is we are ascended with him and we're seated together with him in heavenly places, far above all principalities and powers, every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in the world to come. And the cherubim said, "He's the way." Woo! And Hebrews chapter 6 says, at the very last verse, he said, the forerunner, our great high priest Jesus has entered past the veil. And if he went past the veil and he's our forerunner, then he's saying, "Come on and join me. You can come on in now. I'm not a high priest that can't be touched by your infirmities. I'm opening up the way and you can come in with me." He's not after the order of Levi. He's after the order of Melchizedek. And we are all kings and priests. How many know you're a king and a priest tonight? Stand on your feet right now, folks. Stand up on your feet. Ooh, hallelujah. How many remember reading at the end of the book of Romans? At the end of the book of Romans, after Paul is talking to these Christians and teaching them to be transformed by the renewing of your mind, telling them about being baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, where sin won't have dominion. Everybody say, sin shall not have dominion over you. Hallelujah. At the end of Romans, chapter 16, verse 20, I believe, he said, "And the God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly." Woo! How many believe he crushed the devil's head at the cross? You believe he did it? The resurrection crushed the devil's head? Well, how come he tells people years and years later, "Now, God's going to bruise Satan under your feet"? Because he's not only a high priest that we can follow and go in with. Amen. He's also got power of the devil that he gave to us. He said, "You shall tread on serpents and scorpions, and nothing shall by any means harm you." You make the devil eat dirt now, church. You make the cancer eat dirt. Make sickness eat dirt. Make filthy wickedness eat dirt. Ooh, hallelujah. And we make the devil relive his greatest nightmare every time we call on the name of Jesus. Amen. And say, "I've got victory. Satan, get behind me." Hallelujah. Woo! Let's praise him right now. Let's praise him right now. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Has the devil been making you eat dirt? Has the devil been making you eat sickness, the filth of wicked sickness? Amen. I've cast demons out, and they must not be able to stand it, because I'm just a few years in this world, and those devils have been around for thousands of years, but Jesus gave me power to cast them out. Hallelujah. Amen. We prayed for Gilbert North. God set him free from bone cancer. God can set you free here tonight. How many believe Jesus made the devil eat dirt? You might say, "Yeah, well, that's Jesus." Hey, wait a minute. Paul said, "You, God will put Satan under your feet now, shortly." Amen. Hallelujah, God. Oh, hallelujah. I want the folks to come to the music right now. Amen. We're going to see the devil eat some more dirt here tonight. How many like to see the devil eat some dirt? Woo, hallelujah. And by the way, when you go to Revelation, and those beasts, the lion, the ox, the eagle, and the man, just like they were in front of the throne room of the garden, they're in front of the throne of God in heaven. And around that throne, what was there around that throne, folks? There was a rainbow. Does anybody remember what color that rainbow was? It wasn't a normal rainbow. It was a rainbow, the color of emerald. Somebody say green. What's green represent? Even in all our culture, green represents something. Life. Life. A life-colored rainbow is around the throne. And when the Lamb of God walks up to that throne and takes the book out of the right hand of him that sat on it, after God said nobody was worthy to go and take the book. How many remember reading that? Nobody was worthy. And then John started crying and weeping and crying so much because no one was worthy. All of a sudden, a voice said, "Weep not. The Lion of the tribe of Judah hath prevailed to open the book and to look thereon." And John swung around, and he might not have seen a lion, but he saw a lamb as it had been slain from the foundation of the earth. And the lamb came and took the book. And then when you go from Revelation 5 into chapter 6, you read thousands and thousands and 10,000 times 10,000 angels worshiped and fell before the four beasts. Fell down and worshiped the one on the throne. Amen. And then all of a sudden, one of the beasts in Revelation 6, the first beast, says, "John." And John looks. Nobody was able to go to that throne. And all of a sudden, one of the beasts is talking to John. "John, come." What? What? I just heard a voice say, "No man was worthy to open the book." And I cried so bad. He said, "But I told you to weep not, didn't I?" "Yeah, you told me to stop weeping. Now, come on, John, come and look at the book." You mean I can go to the one on the throne like he did? I can go right over there when I couldn't go before? That beautiful green rainbow of life, I can be right there when no man was worthy? That's right, because everybody can come now. Everybody can come now. Hallelujah. How many are thankful? Jesus paid the way. He's the Ark of Noah. He's the Ark of the Covenant. Amen. How many remember what was inside the Ark of the Covenant? The rod of Aaron, the Ten Commandments, and the budding, or the bowl of manna. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. It's all in him. The fullness of the Godhead is all in him. Hallelujah. He's the Ark of the Covenant. And he's opened up the way. How many are glad you got inside of the Ark called Jesus Christ? You glad you got inside of the Ark? Hallelujah, God. I want to pray tonight over anybody that needs healing. Or you've been tormented. You don't have to tell us what it is. You don't have to tell anybody here what it is. All you have to do is tell him. Yes. And if it's been any kind of dirt the devil's been making you eat, you don't have to eat it anymore, folks. Yes. We're going to make Satan eat it instead. Yes. How many believe what I'm preaching tonight? Oh, hallelujah. Let's worship. Amen. Let's get the minstrels singing and praising. As one brother said, he inhabits the praises of his people. Let's praise God. And call out to God. Talk to him right now while we're getting ready. Father, tell him what your need is. Tell him where you've been eating dirt. Tell him what the devil has been putting you through. And realize you don't have to go through it anymore. Hallelujah. And if you've got victory tonight, you pray for somebody here that needs it. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And I want you to come right now if you need prayer. Amen. Right now. Is there anybody here that needs prayer? Thank you, Jesus. Let's make